Hey everyone, always remember, ignorance of the law excuses no one. This is Legally Engineered. Everyone, good day. I'm Attorney Bendrick E. Maralit, and together with me,
I'm Attorney April
M. And we are here to discuss Module 3
of Law 201, the Law on Obligations
and Contracts. And before we proceed with our discussion of Module 3, it's important for us to have a brief recap of what we actually discussed in the past modules that we have.
Yes.
Attorney, ano ba yung napag-usapan natin from the past?
Having acquired the basic knowledge of the general provisions pertaining to obligations as discussed in the previous modules, the next step to the better understanding of the subject is to discuss the nature and effect of obligations. So, this module covers articles 1163 to 1178 of the new Civil Code of the Philippines.
Yes, so 1163 to 1178 kasi tapos na tayo sa 1156
yes.
to 1162 of the new Civil Code na nakita natin doon yung ano ba yung definition of an obligation.
Yes, sa 1156 nandun yung definition of an obligation. Again, is a juridical necessity to give
to do or not to do. And in 1157, we discussed the sources of the obligations.
Yes.
They are law, contracts, quasi-contracts, delicts, and quasi-delicts.
Yes.
So, and then inisa-isa natin yun hanggang natapos natin ang 1162. And now we are here in 1163 to 1178 as part of our module 3.
Yes,
now, Attorney Uy, ano ba ang intended learning outcome natin for this module?
Yes, so at the end of this module, the student should be able to enumerate the duties of the debtor and the remedies of the creditor in real and personal obligations and discuss the concepts of fraud, negligence, delay, and contravention of the terms of the obligation and the grounds for liabilities and their effects to the rights and duties of the parties. And last, yung determine the requisites of fortuitous events in order to exempt the obligor from liability.
Yes, so medyo marami tayo ditong legal terms na pumasok dun pa lang sa debtor and creditor as well as remedies.
And duties
nila. So, i-define natin sino ba si debtor, sino ba si creditor, at ano ba yung mga duties, responsibilities ng bawat isa. And nasabi nga ni Attorney Uy, pag-usapan din natin yung fraud, negligence, di ba? So may mga, yan yung mga legal parlance na meron talaga siyang exact definition
yes.
By law na ating pag-aaralan dito. And lastly, yun nga, fortuitous event, makikita natin yan at the latter part of the module. So wag na natin patagalin ba, start na tayo agad-agad sa Chapter 2, The Nature and Effect of Obligations. Under starting with Article 1163. So,
yes,
ano ba ang Article 1163?
So, Article 1163 of the Civil Code, ang sabi doon, every person obliged to give something is also obliged to take care of it with the proper diligence of a good father of a family, unless the law or the stipulation of the parties requires another standard of care.
Mm-hmm.
So, before we discuss the meaning of the provision, let us first define the term specific or determinate thing.
Mm-hmm. So tama yun, no? Kasi dun sa 1163 may nabanggit nga doon na obligation to give a
yes.
specific or determinate thing kasi nga it pertains to the this provision pertains to that obligation to give a specific or determinate thing. So mahalagang pag-usapan natin ano ba yung specific real obligation na meron tayo. And you know, a thing is said to be a specific or determinate if particularly designated or physically segregated to others of the same class. So that's under Article 1459 of the Civil Code. So kapag daw siya ay particularly designated
or physically segregated to others
of the same class.
Of the same class, yun daw ay
specific or determinate. So siguro bigyan natin sila ng example para mas ma-visualize nila, no? Can you give an example, Attorney Uy?
So ang example niyan is yung the watch I am wearing.
Mm-hmm.
Attorney Bendrick's watch.
Yes. And this came from my fiancé, by the way. Thank you.
Yes.
So this particular watch is a specific or determinate thing. Mm-hmm. And attorney, Uy, may naisip ka ba bang example ng specific or determinate?
For example, is a 100 peso bill with serial number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Napaka-particular niyan. Isa lang. Yan.
Kasi unique,
oh, unique
yung serial number niya. Mm-hmm. So for example, yung I have a dog, the dog, my pet dog is named Miguel. So my dog Miguel is considered as specific or determinate. Oh, rest in peace to my favorite dog.
Pwede din naman yung car. Red Toyota Fortuner with plate number AMU0406 and 2017 model.
Oh, so kapag sinabi kong red Toyota Fortuner, parang hindi siya
papatak sa specific.
Papatak siya dun sa another sunod, example. So ano ba yung sunod, Attorney Uy?
Yun naman yung i-distinguish natin ito mamaya, yung generic or indeterminate thing. So a thing is generic or indeterminate when it refers only to a class or genus to which it pertains and cannot be pointed out with particularity.
Alright. Mm-hmm. So hindi mo siyang matukoy.
Yes.
Particularly, so example nito, halimbawa, gold Casio digital watch. Uh-huh. So we know that it's a gold Casio, it's a digital watch, but we don't know exactly, o, hindi mo agad ma-point out alin ba doon.
Uh-huh. May class lang siya.
Yes. Uh-huh. It's belonging to a genus or a class, pero particularity wise wala, uh-huh, hindi mo ma-point out. Generic.
Yes,
can you give more examples?
Yung kaninang example natin, yung red Toyota Fortuner 2017 model.
Uh-huh. So yung pinagkaiba iba niyan ngayon dun sa kanina. Yung kanina kasi nakalagay yung plate number.
Yes, particularly designated.
Mm-hmm. E pag may plate number, iisa rin yun. Unique
yes,
din yun. So,
oo.
Unique yun sa kanya. For example, 100 peso bill.
Oo.
So, yung kanina kasi, kaya natin nasabi na yung 100 peso bill ay specific or determinate kasi nilagay natin yung serial number of the 100 peso bill. Pero tanggalin mo yung serial number nun, magiging
generic or indeterminate.
Alright. Uh-huh. So, since nagbigay naman tayo ng examples, siguro mas maganda, establish natin, ano ba yung pagkakaiba, distinction ng specific at ng generic thing.
So, una, yung distinction nila, yung specific or determinate thing is identified by its individuality, while yung generic or indeterminate thing is identified only by its species.
Mm-hmm. So, halimbawa nga dyan, dun sa nabanggit natin na example, mm-hmm, if it's identified by its individuality, yung sa 100 peso bill, mm-hmm, nakalagay nga dun yung kanyang serial number, ano na, identify na yung individuality of
yes,
nung tinutukoy
natin. Isa lang yun.
Nag-iisa yun.
Oo, wala nang ibang 100 peso bill na may 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 na serial number.
Now, magiging generic or indeterminate yun kapag nga, halimbawa, it's only identified by its species.
Yes.
So we know that the 100 peso bill belongs to a species of 100 peso bill.
Yes.
But as to what particularly the serial number is, hindi yun
provided. Napakadaming 100 peso bill. Pwedeng 100 peso bill dati pa. O pwedeng yung ngayon, madami ding 100 peso bill.
Yeah, so we don't really know yung specific or particularity na.
Yes.
Now, another distinction nila is that the debtor, pagdating sa specific or determinate thing, the debtor cannot substitute it with another without the consent of the creditor. Although, the substitute is of the same kind and quality. So, ang mangyayari nito guys, kasi dito napapasok yung consent ng ating creditor.
Yes.
Kasi nga, kapag specific or determinate yung napag-usapan, ikaw na debtor, hindi ka pwedeng at your own decision mag-substitute ka ng ibibigay mo sa creditor. Kasi nga,
kahit pa of the same quality and of the same kind. Or kahit pa inferior, kahit pa superior yung quality, hindi rin pwede. Lalo na kung inferior,
yes,
hindi rin pwede.
Kasi nga, napagkasunduan ninyo na yung specific na bagay na yun or thing na yun ang ibibigay mo.
Yes. Cannot substitute another without the consent.
Without the consent.
Creditor.
So kung
kahit
may consent,
pa same, so kung may consent, edi pwede.
Oh, for example, pwede ko bang sabihin sa iyo na
yung agreement natin, for example.
Halimbawa, agreement natin, I'll be giving you the red Toyota Fortuner with plate number AMU0406-2017.
Yeah, so specific 'yan, yung thing. Mm-hmm. So sabi, it cannot be substituted with another, mm-hmm, even if of the same quality and of the same kind without the consent of the creditor.
So kung halimbawa ang ganito, Attorney Uy, di na pagkausapan natin ngayon na ibebenta ko sa iyo yung red Toyota Fortuner with plate number AMU0406-2017. However, I have another red Toyota Fortuner na 2018 naman to.
Yes. Or 2017 din.
Oh, pwede rin 2017.
Oh, 2017. Same quality. Same kind.
Yes.
Iba lang ang plate number.
Yes. What if, for example, Attorney Oy, I decided na may sentimental value sa akin yung napag-usapan natin na red Toyota Fortuner na yun with a specific plate number. So, I decided na yung isa na lang. Kasi
ay, tapos ayokong pumayag na ay hindi, gusto ko talaga yung AMU 0406 na plate number kasi April MO yun eh. Stands for AMU. Kaya gusto ko talaga yun, nagkataon. So hindi pwede, kung walang consent ko, hindi niya pwedeng palitan.
Yes, so I, as a debtor, cannot substitute the red Toyota Fortuner originally agreed by us as specific or determinate thing.
Yes.
Now, ano yung counterpart nun dun sa generic and indeterminate?
Sa generic naman or indeterminate thing, the debtor can give anything of the same class as long as it is of the same kind. Ano yan? So, kagaya kanina, kung ang napag-usapan lang natin is mag-deliver ka sa akin ng red Toyota Fortuner 2017 model. So, that is generic.
Yes, generic.
So, you can substitute it with another red Toyota Fortuner 2017 of the same kind.
So, kahit ibang plate number.
Oo, kasi ang agreement lang natin is to give a generic thing. Ang tawag doon, generic real obligation.
Yes. So, guys,
bakit real obligation? Bakit generic real obligation? Kasi obligation to give. Uulitin, yun yung diniscuss natin before. Yung obligation to give, real obligation yun, or obligation to deliver. Kapag obligation to do or not to do, personal. It is personal obligation, positive or negative.
Yes, that's correct. And guys, kung mapapansin ninyo, we started chapter 2 in the nature and effect of obligations with explaining the difference, distinction between specific and determinate thing. Kasi magkaiba ang magiging duties and responsibilities and rights of the parties kung specific or kung generic.
So, first, you have to determine, sa isang obligation, you have to determine first kung ito ba ay generic or specific yung thing. Yun muna ang una mong titingnan. Yeah. Kasi kapag generic, iba ang rights, iba ang remedies. Kapag kapag generic, iba pa rin ang rights, iba pa rin ang remedies.
Alright, so since na pag-usapan na rin naman natin, Attorney Oy, yung rights and remedies, duties and obligations, maybe it's the best time for us to discuss the duties of the debtor in obligation to give or to deliver a specific or determinate thing or specific real obligation. So, ano ba ang duties ng debtor?
First is to preserve the thing. Mm-hmm. Pangalawa is to deliver the fruits of the thing. The third one is to deliver the accessories and the accessions. Fourth is to deliver the thing itself. And fifth is to answer for damages in case of non-fulfillment or breach.
Alright, so you've just mentioned five duties of the debtor, no? Mm-hmm. And actually, kung titingnan mo naman, yung una natin, yung preserve the thing, may binanggit kasi sa 1163, guys. Kung titingnan nyo, sinabi sa 1163 that yung every person obliged to give something is also obliged to take care of it with the proper diligence of a good father of a family. So, yun yung ginamit ng law, ng batas, no? Proper diligence of a good father of a family. So, that's preserving the thing.
Yes.
Kasi nga, sabi natin, in obligations to give a specific thing or specific real obligations, the obliger or debtor has the incidental duty to take care of the thing due with the diligence of a good father of a family. Ano ba yung diligence of a good father of a family, Attorney?
So, another term for diligence of a good father of a family, ito yung ordinary care or ordinary diligence, pwede din yung due diligence.
Mm-hmm.
Or that diligence which an average or reasonably prudent person would exercise over his own property.
So, lagi bang, Attorney, ang degree of diligence required is an ordinary care or diligence of a good father of a family or due diligence?
So, that is the standard. Ibig sabihin, kapag walang law or if there's no law or if there's no stipulation providing for the diligence to be exercised by the debtor, you follow the diligence of a good father of a family or yung due diligence. However, nakalagay sa second clause ng Article 1163 that if unless the law, the stipulation of the parties requires another standard of care. So ibig sabihin, if there is a law requiring another standard of care, you follow that.
Or if they've stipulated another standard of care.
Yes, or if they stipulated another standard of care, you follow the stipulation.
Yes, kasi nga, other than the due diligence of a good father of a diligence of a good father of a family or ordinary care, pwede siyang maging slight or extraordinary diligence. Depende sa hinihingi ng stipulation of the parties or ng batas na meron tayo.
For example, when it comes to common carrier, under the law on common carriers, ang sabi doon, kailangan mag-exercise ng extraordinary diligence in the safety of passengers or vigilance over the goods. Mm-hmm.
So, example nga yung common carrier na meron tayo is like yung mga pumapasada nating jeep.
Public transportation.
Public transportation. Very important yan and expressly provided ng batas na hindi lang ordinary diligence or diligence of a good father of a family.
Kailangan extraordinary diligence ang kailangan exercise. So that is provided by law. Yeah. So hindi mo i-exercise yung sinasabi sa 1163 na due diligence or diligence of a good father of a family. What you need to follow or you need to observe is extraordinary diligence if provided by law.
Yeah, actually, nakakatawa ka nga kasi ako, in my previous classes, I would always tell my students na, for example, diba, danas nyo yan, pag nakasakay kayo sa jeep, parang nangangarera yung jeep kasi minsan, habol sa pasahero. So minsan, talagang feeling mo, katapusan mo na.
Biyahing langit.
I would always tell my students na they could actually call out the jeepney driver and tell the jeepney driver that, hey, you have a responsibility, an obligation to us to exercise extraordinary diligence. Diba? Kasi what you're doing by speeding up or hindi ka nag-exercise ng extraordinary diligence, you are putting our life at stake.
Yes.
Diba?
And there is also a presumption of negligence.
Yes. Kapag nangyari yung aksidente, may presumption of negligence talaga yan. Kasi nga, extraordinary diligence ang nire-require sa kanila. Alright, so attorney, we were just then discussing the first of the five duties of a debtor in a specific real obligation. Now, there are still four. Saan ba madidiscuss tong apat na to?
So, yung second duty is to deliver the fruits of the thing, which will be discussed later on. So, yung Article 1164. Tapos yung deliver the accessions and accessories under Article 1166 and deliver the thing itself under Articles 1233 and 1244 in the Civil Code and answer for damages in case of non-fulfillment or breach under Article 1170 of the Civil Code.
So, madidiscuss natin yan as we go along with the discussion in our Module 3. Now, yung duties naman of debtor in obligation to give or to deliver a generic or indeterminate thing. Ito naman yung pagdating sa generic real obligation. Ano-ano naman yung duties doon? First, to deliver a thing which is of the quality intended by the parties. So, however, Attorney Oy, when the quality
and circumstances thereof have not been stated, the creditor cannot demand a thing of a superior quality, and neither can the debtor deliver a thing of inferior quality. The purpose of the obligation and other circumstances shall be taken into consideration. Nandun yan sa Article 1246 of the Civil Code.
Right. Yes. And next to that would be to be liable for damages. Kasi in case of fraud,
damages in case of fraud, negligence, delay, contravention of the terms or tenor of the obligation under Article 1170 of the Civil Code. So under generic real obligation, specific real obligation, meron silang common duty to be liable for damages in case of non-fulfillment due to delay, fraud, negligence, and contravention of the tenor.
So, interesting na pag-usapan yan under Article 1170 kasi ito yung isa sa main source ng dispute between debtor and creditor. Alright. So, we're just done with Article 1163 and palalimin natin yung ating knowledge when it comes to the nature and effects of obligation. So, under Article 1164, the code provides that the creditor has a right to the fruits of the thing from the time the obligation to deliver it arises. However, he shall acquire no real right over it until the same has been delivered to him. So may napag-usapan dito na fruits, ano ba yan? Mangga, mansanas, pinya.
Actually, under the civil code, meron tayong three kinds of fruits. Unang-una yung natural fruits, pangalawa yung industrial fruits, at patatlo yung civil fruits.
So iisa-isahin natin. Yes. So hindi pala pinya, ano lang.
Pwede naman.
Pwede rin.
Oo, pwede rin yun.
Pero hindi talagang prutas
lang. Madaming
Ah, so mag-start tayo sa natural fruit.
Yes.
Natural fruit, ano ba ito?
The spontaneous products of the soil and the young and other products of animals.
Sa example nito, yung mga grass na meron tayo, damo. Bakit nasabi natin na ang damo ay isang natural fruit? Kasi spontaneous product of the soil.
Walang hindi mo tanim. Naman kailangan itanim yung grass para tumubo.
Unless carabao grass, hindi tinanim mo sa...
Bermuda,
itinanim mo talaga yun. So, pero pag spontaneous, wala naman nagtanim yan, basta na lang sumulo yan,
tumubo. Without human intervention, tumubo.
Yes, natural fruit yan. Yung all trees and plants on the lands produced without the human intervention of human labor. So for example, Attorney Uy, yun nga sinabi ko, carabao grass, tinanim ko sa ano namin, sa bakura namin. Would you consider that as a natural fruit?
May human intervention, hindi na siya natural fruit. Magiging industrial fruit na siya.
Yeah.
Kaya nga may human intervention dahil industrial.
So, punta na tayo sa industrial fruits.
Industrial fruits, those produced by lands of any kind through cultivation or labor.
So, nag-cultivate ka ng land, nag-exert ka ng labor, may human intervention. Example dyan, sugarcane.
Tanong mo kanina na pinya.
Pinya.
Mais. O, tutubo ba yung pinya spontaneously or you have to cultivate?
Well, generally, yan kasi yung mga tinatanim yan sa farm, di ba? So, yung mga pinya, it has to be cultivated. Meron talaga nagtatanim yan, may nagsasaka yan. So, hindi mo pwedeng sabihin na yung spontaneous product of the soil. Generally, hindi yan matatawag na spontaneous product of the soil kasi nga, normally, pina-farm yan, sinasaka. Cultivate, may human intervention. So, example ba dyan, sugarcane?
Sugarcane.
Sa inyo, marami sa inyo tumutubo.
Sa amin, madaming
tubuhan. Tubuhan, di ba?
Sugarcane. Hindi naman siya tutubo lang ng basta-basta. Inaararo yan, tinatanim.
So, vegetables.
Right, palay.
Palay. So, sa amin sa Mindoro, maraming palay doon, mga palayan doon.
Oo, yung kanila naman palayan.
Yes. And hindi naman nga basta maghahasik or...
Hindi ba siya tutubo?
Tutubo, na walang naghasik.
Oo, nawalang naghasik.
So, inahasik yan ng mga farmers. Bago maihasik yun, kailangan mo munang araruin. I-cultivate yung lupa na meron tayo. Nagamit ka ng kalabaw, ganyan, araro, ganyan, traktora.
Kasi may nagtanong sa akin na student ko before, paano ma'am yung mga kagaya ng papaya? Pag tinapon mo daw yung buto, may tutubo.
Oo.
Di pwede na din yung natural fruit.
So that could be considered as a natural fruit. Alright? So, yun. And basta ang tandaan nyo lang guys, pag may human labor, may cultivation, or may human intervention dyan, that is already considered as an industrial fruit. In the absence of that cultivation or human intervention, you treat it as a natural fruit.
Again, sa natural fruit din pala, kasama din doon yung products. And products of animals.
Maganda example nun. Yung pangmanak, naman ba? Meron
birds.
Pang, yes.
Ganun.
Dumarami sila. Wala namang human intervention doon.
Wala may human intervention pag nangitlog yung
wala rin namang midwife na magpapaanak sa bird.
Tsaka walang human intervention kasi both birds ang gumawa noon.
Yes. So that's considered as a natural fruit. Okay? So bakit ba ito mahalaga? Later on, we'll find out ang kahalagahan itong iba't ibang uri ng fruits na meron tayo. So, nabanggit mo na natin ang natural fruits, ang industrial fruits. Meron pangatlo pa?
Yung civil fruits.
Civil fruits?
Ano naman yung civil fruits?
Yung civil favorite ko yan, kasi civil engineer ako. So, tapos kong magpa-design dyan ng bahay. Tawag. BM is okay, no? Just kidding. Civil fruits, those derived by virtue of a juridical relation, no? So, siguro i-explain natin through examples.
So example niyan, yung rents of buildings, mm-hmm. prices of leases of lands and other property, and the amount of perpetual or life annuities or other similar income. Mm-hmm. O yung renta daw ng mga buildings, yun daw ay civil fruits. Kasi tsaka may, yung mga interest.
Yes.
Oh,
kasi may nakakreate nga na juridical relation, relation between a lessor and a lessee, renter and landlord, or yung may-ari ng apartment. Halimbawa kayo, yung mga estudyante dyan na nagbo-boarding house, di ba? Kapag nakatira kayo dun sa boarding house, nagre-rent kayo, yung ibinabayad niya sa inyong landlord or dun sa may-ari ng apartment, that is considered
as civil fruit.
Yung rent na binabayad. Mm-hmm.
Okay, yung interest.
The interest. Mm-hmm. Then, na meron.
Pag-utang.
Yes, because there is a juridical relation between a debtor and a creditor, a borrower and lender. So, civil.
Lesser lessee.
Yes, lesser lessee. Okay? So, nabanggit na natin itong
duties,
no? Yung kanina. Ngayon naman, under 1164, creditor yung pinag-usapan dito, right? The rights of the creditor. So,
and again, it applies only to a specific real obligation, yung Article 1163 and 1164. Kasi, kapag naman generic real obligation, wala kang right to the fruits.
So, makikita nyo na rin naman guys sa provision ng 1164, mm-hmm. that is actually a real obligation kasi may sa clause naman sa first part nung ating provision is when from the time the obligation to deliver it arises. So, to deliver, to give, it's a real obligation. So, punta na tayo din, Attorney Uy, and intindihin naman natin ano ba ang karapatan, ano ba ang right ng creditor to the fruits na tinatawag na yun.
Yes, or kung kailan entitled yung creditor sa fruits. So, sabi dyan, the creditor is entitled to the fruits of the thing to be delivered from the time the obligation to make delivery of the thing arises. Mm-hmm. The intention of the law is to protect the interests of the obligee should the obligor commit delay, purpose or otherwise in the fulfillment of his obligation.
Mm-hmm. So, may nabanggit ka dyan, Attorney Oy, na may karapatan daw sa creditor dun sa first of the thing to be delivered
from the time
na yung
the duty to deliver it arises. Mm-hmm.
Kapag dumating na daw yun. So, siguro, pag-usapan natin when would the obligation to deliver arise ba?
Well,
generally, the obligation to deliver the thing due and the fruits thereof, if any, arises from the time the perfection of the contract or to the meeting of minds between the parties. That's under Article 1305, 1315, 1319 ng Civil Code. Contracts na yan. So, at the time daw that there has been a perfection and there has been a meeting of minds, generally, dun na daw nag-arise yung obligation to deliver the thing. But if the obligation is subject to a suspensive condition or period, ano mangyayari?
Yung suspensive condition or period, ang effect niyan is to suspend the fulfillment of the obligation. Mm-hmm. So, ibig sabihin lang yan, the obligation to deliver arises upon the fulfillment of the condition or arrival of the period.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But can the parties actually stipulate anything to the contrary that's na mentioned?
The parties may make a stipulation to the contrary as regards the right of the creditor to the fruits of the thing. So, kahit na merong yung obligation is subject to a suspensive condition or suspensive period, pwede pa rin i-stipulate ng parties yung right of the creditor to the delivery of the fruits of the thing.
Mm-hmm. So, wait lang. May nabanggit kasing suspensive condition or period. May utang tayo sa kanila kasi explain natin yung suspensive condition or period dun sa latter topics na meron tayo. No? Pero reserve natin yun for now. So, siguro, sino na mapag-usapan naman natin ang contract na rin dito in a way, bigyan natin siya ng example when it comes to a contract of sale.
Yes.
Kasi yan naman yung, katulad yung kanina, yung bentahan ni Kokoy at saka ni Jam dun sa specific horse na meron tayo. In that case, Attorney Oy, when would the obligation arise dun sa agreement na yun?
Yes, so ang sabi, in a contract of sale, the obligation arises from the perfection of the contract, even if the obligation is subject to a suspensive condition or suspensive period where the price has been paid. Mm. So, yan.
And there has been a payment already of the price.
Yes.
Halimbawa, guys, ganito ha. Perfect din na yung contract of sale between Kokoy and Jam.
Yes.
Tapos, nakapagbayad na rin naman ng price
si Jam.
But pending the delivery, nanganak ang horse.
Nanganak. Sino nang entitled?
Sino entitled dun sana? Yung mga ganyang dispute ng pag-uusapan natin dito. And unang question dyan, anong fruit yun? What kind of fruit would that be?
Eh,
A. A, natural fruit.
B, natural fruit. C, natural fruit. Yeah. D, all of the above. A, B, C, D.
Okay, so malalaman natin yun dyan. And yun nga, kasi nga, pag-uusapan doon, sino nga ang entitled doon sa bagong anak? Bisiro ba tawag doon?
Cult
ba is bisiro yung Tagalog? Hindi ko rin alam yun.
Sorry, cult ang alam ko.
So, Attorney Uy, pinag-usapan natin yung example ni Kokoy at ni Jom, yung obligation ni Kokoy to deliver a specific horse to Jom. And pending, nakapagbayad na si Jam kay Kokoy and pending the delivery, for example, on September 27 as given in the example ng anak ngayon, si horse, nagkaroon ng anak yung colt.
Halimbawa, September 27 pa talaga, i-deliver dapat ni Kokoy yung horse. Pero nagbayad ngayon si Jam, September 13, nagbayad si Jam ng 15,000 pesos as purchase price for the horse. Mm-hmm. So ang tanong, ngayong kinabukasan
ng anak
yung horse, who is now entitled to the yam of the horse?
Comment down below for answer. No, joke lang.
Sino nga ba?
Alright, so in that case, guys, ang may karapatan noon, malinaw naman ang sinasabi ng batas, since there has already been a perfection of the contract, there has already been a payment of the purchase price on the part of Jam, then yung entitled dun sa quote would be si Jam as the creditor. Kasi nga, at that time, yung entitled na dun sa fruit, in this case, the natural fruit would be the creditor.
The creditor, kasi he has already paid the purchase price. Even if subject suspensive period yung delivery. Pero, if kung hindi nagbayad pa si Jam ngayong September 13, for example, hindi siya nagbayad, at kinabukasan, September 14, ay nanganak ang horse, kanino yung ownership or sino na magmamayari ng horse?
Alright, so Attorney Uy, as to your question, ang nangyari naman is that nanganak nga yung specific horse ng yung horse ng anak ng September 14, no?
Correct.
Eh, September 27 pa i-deliver. Wala pa namang
pinabayad si
purchase
Jam.
Price si Jam. Mm-hmm. So, the question now before us is who has the right over the natural fruit, in this case, the colt, to which the law would answer in favor of
the seller
si that is Kokoy. Kasi nga, Kokoy has a right to the colt if it was born before the obligation to deliver the horse has arisen and B has not yet paid the purchase price. And on September 14, the day the colt was born, the buyer has not yet paid the purchase price and the suspensive period, which is September 27, has not yet arrived. So, we hope malinaw sa inyo yon yung dalawang particular situation that we have. Who has the right over the natural fruit?
Yan yung in a contract of sale.
In a contract of sale. Correct. Example na meron tayo. Okay? Mm-hmm. So, yes. But now, there is a question as to ownership.
Yes.
Attorney Uy.
Ownership
acquired.
Naman ngayon.
Who acquires the ownership by...
Yes.
How do we acquire pala?
Ownership. Hindi, we acquire ownership by delivery.
Mm-hmm.
Delivery either... actual delivery or constructive delivery. So, Attorney Marali, ano muna yung actual delivery? Magbigay ka ng example ng actual delivery.
Actual delivery. For example, huwag na tayong lumayo sa example natin ng specific horse na i-deliver. Diba? Actual delivery is yung pagdating din kay Kokoy at kay Jam, on the day of September 27, daladala ko yung
Horse.
Binigay ko kaya.
Yun yung actual delivery. Actual na deliver. Na-receive ko. Or yung mga favorite kasi nila ngayon, yung mga Lazada, Shopee. Yan. Favorite nila. Lagi nila yung binibigay na example. Pag tinatanong ko sila dati. Lagi yung mga, diba, umorder ka kay Shopee or Lazada, i-deliver sa bahay. That is actual delivery. How about constructive delivery? Paano naman
constructive
yun?
Delivery naman. Halimbawa, bumili ako ng house and lot.
Yes, diba? Yan yung most prominent example. Mm-hmm. Yung mga lupa. Kasi hindi naman siya pwedeng actual delivery. Hindi naman pwedeng i-deliver. Ito na yung house and lot. Kung laruan lang yun.
Yes.
Pwede.
So, halimbawa, bumili ako ng house and lot kay... Huwag na tayo magpangalan dito kasi masyadong sisikat-sikat na yung...
Kay Cynthia.
Cynthia Lostor. Oo, kay Cynthia. So, for example, bumili ako ng housing lot sa isang developer. Mm-hmm. Hindi naman nga actually, mag-deliver sa akin ngayon.
Hindi pwede ang actual delivery.
So, kapag the fact na, halimbawa, ibinigay na sa akin yung susi ng bahay. Ayan.
Or kaya yung certificate of title
nung lot na meron tayo. Uh-oh. That is a constructive delivery of the property itself. Yes. Kasi nga, the fact na nasa yun yung certificate of title or yung susi ng mismong bahay binigay sa iyo, that is as if
there has been a delivery.
And you acquired ownership over the same thing. Through that constructive delivery.
Same is true when it comes to car. Hindi mo lang ng susi.
Yes, kapag yung susi ng kotse binigay na sa iyo when you bought it. Okay, attorney, sa second clause ng Article 1164, it is stated there that however, he pertaining to the creditor shall acquire no real right over it until the same has been delivered to him. So, there is a phrase here, he shall acquire no real right over it until the same has been delivered to him. Ano ba ibig sabihin?
So, ibig sabihin, kapag walang delivery, either actual or constructive, the creditor does not become the owner thereof.
Mm-hmm. Kapag ang i-deliver nga is a specific thing, no? Kailangan i-deliver. Hence, when there has been no delivery yet, the proper action of the creditor is not one for recovery of possession, but
for specific performance or rescission of the obligation with damages.
Kasi kung halimbawa, you would want to file an action against the debtor
for non-delivery,
you cannot file recovery of possession and ownership kasi in the first place, sabi nga natin, you would only acquire ownership when the same has been delivered to you.
And the fact that you're not yet the owner.
So, ang gawin mo, mag-file ka ng specific performance to deliver the same or mag-rescind ka nilang ng contract or obligation.
I-cancel yung obligation.
Decision of the obligation.
Plus damages.
Gusto mo, bahala ka kung ilang magkano gusto mo. Yan, so,
ibibayad ka naman.
Yes. So, dito, attorney Oy, maganda siguro pag-usapan natin. Ano ba yung personal right?
Versus real right. Kasi nabanggit din nga dun sa 1164, dun sa second sentence, yung real right.
Shall acquire no real right. So, meron bang non-real right? Ano ba yun?
Personal.
Ano ba yan? Ano ba difference?
So, yung as to definition muna, ang personal right is the right or power of a person or the creditor to demand from the debtor the fulfillment of the latter's obligation to give, to do, or not to do.
So, yung power niya to demand, no? Power ng creditor
to demand the fulfillment of an obligation to do, to give or not to do.
So, real right naman, yes, ang counterpart definition naman yan sa real right as to definition is that this is the right or interest of a person over a specific thing. Like, for example, ownership or possession of the specific thing. Mortgage or lease record na meron tayo over the property without a definite passive subject against whom the right may be personally enforced. So, itong real right na ito, it can be enforced against the whole world, actually,
yes.
Diba?
Wala mong sinabi dyan na debtor. Mm-hmm. Dito sa personal right, may debtor and creditor.
Specific,
yes. And the creditor is asserting his right against the debtor.
The debtor.
Yes.
So, pwedeng may dumating na third person other than the debtor who may claim a better right over the same property. Correct. Kasi nga, personal right lang yung meron siya against the specific debtor na pinag-usapan natin. Unlike sa real right, ano yan? Binding.
Yes, kahit walang debtor, walang nagka-claim na iba, you can assert your right to the whole world.
Binding yan sa whole world na meron tayo.
Kasi yan yung ownership. You can assert it to everybody.
Yes. Right. Now, as to subject naman, Attorney Uy, ano ba yung personal right as to subject?
Yes. So, as to yung personal right as to subject, there is a definite active subject and a definite passive subject. Yun ang sinasabi ko, may debtor, may creditor, laging may kagalit.
May kaaway.
Laging may nakaaway sa'yo.
Samantalang kapag real right naman, there is only a definite active. Sabi natin, pag active, creditor yan, di ba?
Yes.
Active subject, without any definite passive subject. So, meron lang nag-a-assert ng right, and that is the creditor, the active subject, over the thing itself. And normally it's against everyone. So walang definite passive subject or debtor na pinag-usapan doon. Okay?
So as to binding force ng personal right, it is binding or enforceable only against a particular person. Yun. May dun sa kaaway mo, binding yun, yung personal
right. Yan, kung kayo lang mag-aaway, kayo lang. Kung kayo man dami ng
iba. Dun sa real right naman, dami-dami
na to.
Dami-dami na to.
Yun. Dami-dami na yan. Kasi pag ikaw nag-prevail dyan, wala, kadami lang.
For example, I am the owner of a parcel of land under the torrent's title registered in my name in the registry of property. And then, my ownership over that parcel of land is a real right directed against everybody. There is no definite passive subject. You see, ito ay example ng real right. Owner ako ng parcel of land registered under the torrents system, yung may torrents title din ako over that land. So I can assert ownership over that parcel of land against the whole world. For example, may lot nga ako. Ngayon, si Attorney Marali ay he took possession of the parcel of land which I own.
So in that case, since ako yung nagpo-possess ng property which rightfully belongs to her kasi established nga kanina na siya yung owner, then si Attorney Uy would have a personal right over me. Personal right kasi there is a definite passive and active subjects na meron tayo. Ako yung definite passive subject as a debtor. So she would have a cause of action.
Yes. Yun yung personal right. Pwede kong paalisin si Attorney Marali, pwedeng action for forcible entry or action for unlawful detainer. As the case may be, pwede kong mag-file nun against Attorney Marali because I am asserting my personal right over a definite passive.
Personal subject. Right to recover from me as a...
So in case there's a judgment rendered by the court, that judgment is binding only against the two of us.
Paano naman Attorney Uy? Kasi diba, normally naman sa ganyan, sa mga usapan ng lupa, real property, may mga mortgage na nangyayari dyan. Diba? So, what if the same land is, for example, mortgage by you to, let's say, to Attorney Leo Hernandez?
Attorney Leo, if yung lot ko ay nakasamla o naka-mortgage kay Attorney Leo Hernandez, kung naka-register or naka-annotate or duly annotated dun sa certificate of title ko yung pagkaka-mortgage ko kay Attorney Hernandez, it is binding against third persons.
So pag sinabi mong binding against third persons, ibig sabihin nun, a purchaser buys the land subject to the mortgage which is a real right siya kasi nga it's registered duly registered. Pero kung hindi yan rehistrado, hindi yan duly annotated.
Yes, hindi siya binding on third person.
So can we consider that just a merely personal right as against the between mortgager and mortgagee?
Yes,
right? Kasi sa kanila lang yan, hindi yan binding sa
third person. Kasi kaya mahalaga ipa-annotate or ipa-register certificate of title para maging binding against third person.
Para warned lahat ng magtatransact over the property.
And boy, yung bibili sa Attorney Marali, interested siyang bilhin. Nakita niya, nakasangla pala kay Attorney Leo. Nakita niya yung certificate of title. Hindi na niya bibili kasi nakasangla pala.
Yes. Or I know the risks that I'm gonna take.
Yes. O kasi... kaya, bibilhin niya, papayag siyang bibilhin, pero alam niya kung anong mga consequences or effects ng pagkakabili niya.
Kasi, remember, lagi naman pag-usapan yan, malinis ba yung titulo?
Yes.
So, pag nakita mo yung may mortgage, under mortgage pala siya, you know, yung risk that you're taking. And, take note guys, na when you're a supposed buyer of a, let's say, a lot, no, it's enough for you to just look at the
certificate of title.
Kapag kita mo namang malinis, you are not required by law to look beyond pa. Diba? So, yun yung rule dyan.